He is Robin Leach. He is Jay DeMarkin. This is Card.
Yes, and I want to congratulate last week's show in my absence because I listened to it. It was quite well done. I approved of the topics that were done, and I think the listeners should have had a good time listening to you too. So congratulations. But I am back, and I have been in Canada skiing, and let me tell you what they're driving up there. They're driving a lot more sedans per vehicle line than we are down here, although obviously the SUVs, Canada is still a winter wonderland, at least on the side of the roads, if not on the roads themselves. There's 6 to 8 feet of snow still up in the higher elevations east of Quebec City, which is making it for the ski areas, the two, Mount St. Anne and Massif, a very nice spring situation.
Quick question.
Yes.
Are there more sedans or more SUVs?
More sedans. There are lots of Subarus, Imprezas. There are Nissans. There are VWs. There are a lot of SUVs as well. But Canadians haven't, at least not in the area I was driving, necessarily neglected the pleasures of sedan driving. In Canada, they have to wear 4 snow tires. I guess it's Canadian law in the wintertime, whether you're two-wheel drive or four-wheel drive. So all the cars are running around with winter tires on rims that they have purchased with those tires, so they can swap them easily at the end of each, the beginning of each season, without having to
Isn't that how it was done before the invention of the SUV?
Is that how it's done?
You used to put snow tires, way back in Buffalo, New York, 9,000 years ago, you used to put snow tires on your car in the winter.
Yeah. And we still should, says the guy who doesn't.
I still have winter tires, some on rims in my garage. I didn't put them on this year. I must say to my listeners, I did not use them this year.
Well, maybe they're rims to cars that he no longer owns.
That's also possible. But the real question, and I just think it's hidden, and maybe we shouldn't all get mentally marketed, because once again, I know a bunch of young people, meaning under the age of 30, who have kids who drive around in sedans. And I'm really sorry, but no one dumped their sedan to go get an SUV.
You've given me the reason to go into this next particular article topic, which I brought up with Jay before we went on the air. And the heading is Flagging Loyalty in the Pickup Market? It's about the rising pricing costs of the newer pickup trucks, which are going up north of $50,000 before you try to negotiate discounts. And apparently, according to this little article, which may not be very authentically correct, they're interviewing pickup owners and young people, and the article is about the flagging loyalty of pickup owners continuing with pickups after they get through their current purchases, or they're going for used ones instead of new ones because they are fully, sometimes as much as 1/3 off of what the new ones cost, and they don't need all that technology. But the key to this article was, when asked what they might buy next if they didn't buy a new pickup, they were thinking about buying sedans.
Because it's cheap.
Hello, Ford and Chevy. Are you listening to this show? You should be, because I don't know where all your expert marketers are telling you that you can just go
all sedans
put the sedans
cheap.
Away.
That's true. They certainly aren't.
The sedans that are actually left.
Well, no, but the Fusions and the Chevy sedans that they're getting rid of as far as productions are cheap. They're in the $30,000 range.
But the
trucks are $60,000. So for 50% less, they can get a car that they're satisfied driving with.
Well, to be simplistic, I mean, the sedans on the market today are reliable forms of transportation, and they happen to be very good cars.
They do.
Namely, Honda Accords and Civic, Toyota Camrys.
Nissan Altima.
So these are cars that are they happen to be sedans, but they're well-built cars. and cheap to operate. And I think, you know, you see young people, you just mentioned young families driving sedans still. I think having once been young and being less young now and having seen a few generations and what the trend is, I think people, you know, have cars when they go to school and they go to college. They drive sedans and then they get married.
Cars,
they have kids and they start putting them in
wagons or SUVs.
And then they get a second kid and then you have to put two modern car seats in a car. And there's no way you can put grandma in the back seat with two kids in car seats. And bingo, here we go for the first SUV. And then it's all downhill from there.
I'm just talking about the way that it's covered from a press standpoint, because guess what, boys and girls, live long enough. What a mystery. SUVs are...
And I said earlier on an earlier show, the attention span of the American manufacturers seems to be awfully short, and they don't want to ride out the lows in the market to where they're going to start coming back. And I'm, you know, maybe in 4 or 5 years, they're going to wish they hadn't gotten rid of the sedans that the American manufacturers are stopping production of, the Tauruses and the Fusions.
Won't they just run and restart production?
Well, they don't have the tooling because they'll have to redesign it, and they'll have to, they amortize the tooling for each model run to the point where they can't depreciate the tooling anymore against their income, so they have to do
like
a
Brexit.
New car.
So, I think this is all a moot point because I think the new big segment of the market is, and we've talked about this over and over again, is small crossover SUVs. And they have and are, and I think will be, mostly replacing sedans because they're not too high, they're not too low, they're not too big, they don't have big gusting engines.
They're not too slow.
And they're not too slow. They're fairly comfortable. You can put a lot of stuff in them. They are, and I think will remain, the mainstream of
vehicle.
Automobile.
One of the reasons.
And some of the marks of those are? What
they're always the same. The Honda CRV, the Jeep
Cherokee,
the Toyota
RAV4s.
And the
Foresters for the Subarus, those kinds. And Jay is probably correct to the degree that we don't get back into the...
Jay? Correct?
Obama attempts at... making car manufacturers have 45 mile per gallon fleet averages, which have all but been delayed by the current administration and hopefully won't come back at that level anytime soon, because SUVs are going to be very hard to, without going to hybrids, make ever achieve 45 miles per gallon. The Jeep Cherokees and some of the new RAV4s are doing well to approach 27 to 30 miles per gallon at highway levels of operation. But the fact of the matter is they are getting up there, and people who sit there and listen to me say as a matter of fact, I got 29 miles per gallon on the trip back from Canada to home on, one tank of gas usage.
How much is gas in Canada?
For anybody, gas in Canada is running $1.24.5 per liter, which is
how many liters in a gallon?
3.8.
Which adds up to
460, I think. Anyways, too much. But diesel is the same price or a few cents Canadian lower in Canada than regular grade gas. So
hasn't that always been?
Yeah, it has always been. In Europe too, I believe, Jay. Is that correct?
In Europe, it has been historically in most countries. That is changing.
To the detriment of diesel prices?
Yes. Okay. Yes. Diesel used to be 30% cheaper, always.
But they're not going higher than regular fuel in Europe.
No, but they're trying to de-dieselize.
Yeah, they're trying to de-dieselize.
Europe's
going
through that too.
I keep seeing ads on social media from VW advertising TDI diesels as the new hip thing, and I love it.
As you would and should.
Yeah.
I don't know how well they're doing it, selling those reprocessed diesels.
They are, because
I've
been looking for some, and I can't find any more.
Really?
Like the Touaregs, you know,
the Touaregs are probably hard to find because they weren't numerically as as available as the Jettas and the other sedans.
A couple of months ago, I went on Auto Trader and I found like a couple hundred of recent CPOs or rebranded new Touareg diesels, and now they're down to, I think, 50 or so.
Well, a couple hundred down to 50 is not hard to achieve. 300,000 Jettas down to 50 would be a lot harder to achieve.
And are there a lot of Jettas running around?
I mean, well, there are. The VW dealers have them because I've been to two or three VW lots.
But what I'm trying to find out from Jay's Auto Trader experience or investigation is
whether there are some, but there are things you cannot find anymore. You cannot find a 2015 or 2016 diesel Golf with a stick shift, for instance, which is one of the coolest cars.
Again, though, a very low production vehicle as far as what was appearing in the country. So not eight, 10 years ago.
The
low production version of the Golf, the manual transmissions. The automatics became mostly prevalent, and most people weren't buying them in the first place except for people like Jay.
People who bought diesels in the VW camp
bought manual transmissions.
Proportionally, a higher proportion of manual transmissions than others.
He will fight me to the end of this, but the fact of the matter is there are not that many manual transmission diesel Golfs in the production of Golfs in the U.S., to warrant the fact that they would keep them from staying readily available.
Okay, and unscientifically forgetting you guys, I know someone who bought a diesel and she wanted a manual transmission, and that's the end of the story. So it's like
she got it right.
Yeah.
Oh, good. That's perfect.
Good. I drove an O2 recently in Arizona. Loved it.
Yeah. And this was back.
When did the clean diesels come into the VW line? After O2 or during?
Obviously, we now know never.
Well, touche to you. That's not the true. Moving on.
And P.S. in other lines, too, there was not necessarily clean diesel.
Speaking of Volkswagen, however, in the recall weekly thing that I get in my computer, the only one of note for recalls that has anything to do with possibly significant safety features is a VW Golf Sport Wagon, Jetta, and Tiguan, pending recall. It may not be out yet, ranging model years from 2015 through 2019, which involve rear coil springs. The apparent problem is that they may have been improperly cured, and they may fracture.
If
a spring fractures, you probably will not necessarily have an accident with the car, but you might see a sunken rear quarter, one side or the other of your vehicle, because a spring would break, and it might cause you to veer a little bit off the road, but it is enough of a recall potential safety issue that I thought I'd bring it up for all diesel. I'm not all diesel, all Volkswagen listeners who own Golfs, Golf Sport Wagons, Jettas, or Tiguans between 2015 and 2019. Not all of them are all those 5 years or 4 years, but the 2019s are this year, and you know, it's interesting that these things suddenly appear after all the testing and all the recalls that go on, that we're still getting defective parts going into production model cars.
What was the one from a couple of weeks ago where the doors don't?
Doors open unexpectedly.
That's it, doors open unexpectedly.
Yeah, I think Ford had one, and maybe there were a couple other manufacturers that had trouble with doors opening.
Is it like someone sleeping in the software department? What?
No, doors don't open on software. Those are latches, and they're sometimes electrically applied, and it's possible that they're just not aligned properly. Who knows what that problem is? An open door, as long as you're wearing your seatbelt, is not going to be the end of your life.
So what was the coolest car you saw in Canada?
Teslas.
Thank you.
A Model S happened to be at the same ski area I was at, and I was thinking as we were pulling out of a hill which goes essentially from sea level to 2,000 feet uphill to leave the place, I was trying to calculate how much electrical juice that Tesla Model S was drawing to get up that hill, because it's about a 2-mile hill. And as we know, charged, they will get, if he had the big battery pack, up to 300 miles. And while we were approximately, and this is kilometers, so it's not the same as miles, well within charging station availability probably from the ski area to Quebec City or even Montreal. I was just curious as to how much initial juice a fully charged battery would draw it down to by the time it got to the top, especially since it was cold up there, so the heater was running as well.
Any idea?
Nope.
Okay.
Just a curiosity because of the technology of
electric. The coolest car I saw yesterday on the Hutch, and I thought it, I had the coolest SUV, but I passed, and I did pass it. Was a Lamborghini Urus.
I've seen that.
I've seen that person is
what
around.
What color was it?
It was white.
Yes. That person is around.
This corner?
Down there.
And
I saw it.
I always thought it was ridiculous. You know, I saw pictures. We all saw the first test of the car. I have to tell you, it looks pretty darn cool. And I would not have been driving in the right lane at 50 miles an hour on the Hutch if I had been driving that car. But that's a whole other story.
Well, it's interesting that that car costs a lot of money. And sometimes the people who have that kind of money to spend are in their upper age levels and don't necessarily drive the way Jay would like to think it should have been driven. And I sort of agree with him. But I think I made the
comment with you.
Okay. I made a comment on a show when Jay wasn't here about the fact of the matter is you see all these high-performance cars and you actually go by and look at who's driving them. And they're older people. Now, they may well be able to drive, but they're the people who can afford the $100,000.
Excuse me, how do you know what they do on weekends with that car?
Well, they may go to Lime Rock and do it, but when you have it and you're driving as an everyday driver and you spent $200,000 for it, the satisfaction level is not about actually driving it the way it can be driven as much as owning it.
May I just...
For many people. This isn't a carte blanche. Totally,
100% situation. No, I just find that the furthest, if you're driving the Hutch, if you are heading from here into the city, there's a line that you cross where suddenly vehicles, some of them are more, shall we say, noteworthy than others. They're just and more expensive, driven by.
Well, except that he was driving 50 miles an hour, apparently.
Well, traffic was mostly going 50 miles an hour. He was moving with traffic. Okay. It was the reasonable and right thing to be doing.
Okay,
that's all that was.
That we need to have that kind of comment made before I start criticizing the comment about older people owning these high performance.
In other words, he wasn't going 11 miles an hour. Don't worry.
That's true.
No. Okay,
he wasn't going 11 miles an hour. Apparently, there may be a two-door Bronco in the pipeline, which has yet to have been apparently revealed.
Hold on. We're still waiting for the four-door Bronco.
I know, but we're talking about Ford.
It could be in a couple years from now.
I have been criticizing in myself since the original Bronco was a two-door, which I owned two of back in my day.
Well, I
rolled one and survived to tell about it, and here I am today to talk about it. They were absolutely my favorite vehicle. As Jay said, what is your favorite vehicle? It was probably my favorite vehicle.
And that
vintage one is being redone by car redoers, and they are very expensive out on the market.
Mm-hmm. And I will say this. When the four-door Bronco was first talked about, Robin, you said they need to do a two-door, so... Maybe someone listened.
Well, they would be very smart to have listened. Ford used to have that bright idea, light bulb thing. Ford has a better idea. I haven't been too impressed with Ford's ideas of recent.
Well, look who's CEO. They have a guy who used to make steel
airplanes.
Furniture.
That's right, yes.
Yeah.
Didn't they have an airline person in there involved too?
Yeah.
Anyways, yeah, I tend to have... an issue about who are the experts that are hired by these companies to supposedly make them be successful.
Few and far between.
And the visionary department is dull.
Mm-hmm. It is indeed. Hyundai's trying to revitalize the Sonata. There's a picture of a Sonata in the upcoming edition of Automotive News. Well, it thrills me because I've never been happy with the Sonata except for the one model I own, which happens
to
be a hybrid.
Speaking of hybrids, because are hybrids and are electrics, is that less, do people care less about them now except for the greener group?
I think what's going
to happen... The greener group are buying electric cars.
Right.
Yeah, and I think that they're going to be... the electric cars are going to maybe overtake the hybrids, except the hybrids are good for consistently continuous driving without long layovers for charging. Although I read there is some technology brewing in behind the scenes whereby some engineering minds up in Canada have apparently developed a charging system that can charge a lithium battery pack, albeit small flashlight sizes, in 5 minutes or less.
Well, maybe we should have electrified highways like we have electrified train
rails.
Rails.
Well, there. I believe there is a test electrified highway in one of the Scandinavian countries. I think I saw it a couple of years ago where they had trucks going along and there were electrified charging rails that they rode over in maybe both lanes or not. I don't know how long the test bed was, whereby their batteries were being charged as they were running. I don't know. It hasn't gone very far, and it'd be very expensive to try to electrify our highways. Jay's questioning that, but whether it'll ever get to that point. I may not be around to see it. He may be, and then he'll be able to talk to me through the atmosphere saying, I told you so. I was right on our car show 10, 20 years ago. They've electrified the highways so that you can run electric cars continuously along them without having to stop for charging. Yes, Jay?
Sure.
You will be around for that, I think, if it happens. But it would be very costly to do it. You could do the main. It might be like trying to toll Connecticut's highways if they just did the main road so that your car battery would always be charged if you were to turn off and take side roads up on a tour up into the valleys of California or the mountains of Colorado. Your car would always be at 100% charge level by the time you decide to take that exit and go off to the Grand Canyons, for say, where there wouldn't be any electrified charging roads.
So I read something this morning on another note. You know, we're quick to criticize auto execs and think we could do a better job running GM or Ford or any one of the big companies.
I don't think I could run it better, but I sure think I could help the design departments because look at some of the front ends of these cars.
We'll keep you away from design. But I wanted to get back to manufacturing. And, you know, VW, Ford are big, old car manufacturers. VW, I think, is the biggest car manufacturer in the world. They just struck a deal with Amazon. And you go like, what?
Yeah, what?
And what is, they are working at streamlining production. And Amazon has, technology in the all the supply chain domain that can be useful to VW and other manufacturers. And VW is, and I read this very quickly, and I don't understand much of it.
Good.
But it's all about the cloud and streamlining production between their 120 or so manufacturing plants and their 1,500 suppliers. So the big challenge for these manufacturers on a global level is this effort is, you know, marketing on one side and production on the other, and coordinating that.
This has been going on for decades because I think Japan has what they call a just-in-time production of parts so that they don't have warehouses of parts sitting around waiting to be called on. The problem with just-in-time production, which was a way to streamline to a certain degree production and minimize inventory, was that if there was a strike in one of the plants, all of a sudden they ran out of parts very quickly and didn't have the capability of continuing producing cars while a strike was going on. And that still is the case today if they're doing it, because they have been minimizing warehousing of parts for a long time. This may not go directly to what Jay is talking about with the Amazon situation, but it is part and parcel of continuous attempts at streamlining production so that they didn't have a lot of parts sitting on shelves that not making the money. And also, you know, there was a day back in my early days where you liked to order a car custom and you were willing to wait 8 weeks or 12 weeks or whatever for it to be
those
built
days are
and
gone.
Show
and
up. Those days
you don't
are
even
gone.
Do that anymore. You
no,
just
we
go
don't
in the
do
showroom.
It. That, well, basically, if the shoe fits, you buy it at the moment you see it.
Yep.
And that's true in the showroom and on the line. And there was an article about the Carvana situation. I heard you talk about Carvana. and or maybe Marsha was. And
no, the clock.
Oh, the clock. Oh, my gosh, we're running out of time.
He is Robin Leach. He is Jay DeMarco. This is Car Keys.